Welcome to Randolph Memorial Baptist Church. It's so good to see you today. It's great to be in worship. We are moving along. This is November the 15th. I don't know where the year has gone. In some ways, this year has been the year that never ends with everything going on, but in other ways, it has moved pretty fast. So we're excited to be here. And as we worship today, we want you to, whether you're at home or watching this later in the week or you're here in this room, we're just glad you're participating. And the key word is participating. I hope we don't see this as watching. I know we can't do and engage in all the ways we're used to, but make it a quiet place at home. Read the scripture ahead of time. Say a prayer of focus. Light a candle if it helps, and just kind of make that moment special. Don't do laundry or dishes. Just make it a time where you're just centering on God as you worship, and I think it'll be very meaningful to you. As we begin, before we move into the music, I do know that Veterans Day fell in the very middle of the week. Usually when it leans one Sunday or the next, we say a prayer on that Sunday, and this was, I believe, right split in the middle. And so we want to honor those who are veterans. So if you're a veteran, just stand for a second where you're at. Just stand. If you're a veteran, if you ever served in the military. If you're a veteran at home, stand where you are and have your family give you a little bit of applause there. And so we thank you. And even though it's not in my notes, I'm going to say a prayer for our veterans right now, and then we're going to begin our service. Gracious God, we thank you for the men and women who have served, and we are just grateful. We're thankful for their commitment to protect us and to serve us as people. May we never take that for granted. We are all better people because of it. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, we pray. Amen. Let's begin worship.
Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who shakes the orphan, a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that I would be saved. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Yeah, all that you've done for me.
The work of the church, as you can see, is strong, and there's a lot going on. It's where the Facebook and the website that we have, you can need to be a constant reminder on your phone or screen so you can keep up with what's happening. But there are a lot of things, and I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful for today's worship, for all those you're going to see and going to help you lead and worship. I'm so proud of these folks. So a couple of things I'll tell you. A Bible study tomorrow at 11 a.m. You can watch last week's Bible study either on YouTube or on our Facebook feed, because I know some of you work and some of you are not ready to be in a room and understand. I will tell you, though, we have a couple coming, and it's a big room. You can take a table and pull out by yourself, wear your mask, stay safe. And tomorrow at 11 a.m., we're looking at the Gospel Houses of Christmas, and it will be Matthew. So check it out at home later that day if you work. But if you want to come, you're certainly welcome. But it's been nice to even just have a few in the room, so I'm not just talking to a screen. It just makes it a little bit better. But I think it's going to be a short-term study, but we'll meet this week, and then we'll take a week off for Thanksgiving and then return. On Wednesday, the Bessie Sneed's class will meet at 11 a.m. They welcome anyone to come. After this week, they're going to take a break till the first of the year. Just with the COVID numbers going up and just all that, they're going to take a little bit of a break and then come back at it later. But I'm sure that they'll be in touch with you about things. So this Wednesday, it's been going really good, and I'm thankful for those ladies. Youth will continue to meet at 6:30, Kids in Action and Youth, again, following masks, wearing masks and all the same protocols that the school system follows. Exactly. So that'll be happening. I want you to put on your date book the date December the 1st and not forget it. If it rains, it'll be the next week. But that will be our next food drive. We'll get information out to you. But it's going to be a big day, because when you come by that evening, you will drop off food or you can pick up stuff. What can you pick up? It's your one-stop shop. You can get Sunday school books. If the Sunday school books are in, we're going to give those out. You can also get little communion cups and candles, because our Christmas Eve service will happen, but it will be online. If you remember last year, we had 300 or 400 people in this room, and people from the community come, and we have no control over the crowd control with that many. So we've missed with snow before. We're not going to miss this year. We're just doing it different. I would like to see us get 1,000 people worship with us throughout the whole day on Christmas Eve, because your whole family is captive. Whoever's in your room, they're going to watch worship, right? We're going to worship. And you can have candles and go outside on your porch and sing Silent Night. You can worship at any time you want. So if you want to do it in the dark, in the afternoon, whatever you want to do that day, and you can call your grandchildren in California and say, I'm not sending you that gift till you watch the service. And but it's going to be good. It's going to be an exciting service. The music and everything's going to be good. And I just think that it's wonderful we can do it. I really am. So that's what's going to happen Christmas Eve. So December the 1st will be the pickup for that. You can use your own candles, your own communion piece of things. But if you'd like the little to-go cup and the candle, you certainly can get those from us. So I'm excited about it. I think it's not what I would choose as a first choice, but God teaches us flexibility and innovation. And it just makes it more exciting to think about Christmas next year. And I'm going to say I'm an optimist, and I just believe we are going to be so excited next year. I really do. So I'm feeling good about that. So that's what's happening. I know, last thing I'll say before we continue worship is just a quick note. I know I posted this on Facebook. Friday, you know, there's more restrictions happening in our state. Right now, churches are allowed to continue as we're doing. And I've got the big, thick document. And one of the things it lists are if we meet the things we have to do, and this church is doing them. So I'm proud of this church. But one thing is five year old and up, you have to wear these. 5 years old and up. And 6 feet. So I feel the deacons have really done a great job in leading us on all of the protocols we're following. We're meeting tomorrow night at 6:30. If you have any feedback about physical worship, somebody asked me, what happens if we are told again we can't come or we decide not to come? Will we still worship? Of course. We did not ever stop worshiping, even the very first Sunday, right? We kept going. So if that ever happens, one thing you got to keep in mind is we don't know what could come down the pike no matter what. We don't know. There are some states that have shut down. So the church sign and the Facebook will tell you if anything changes with worship. You just got to check that. But we will never stop worship. If we were ever forced to or chose not to meet, whichever way we go, if we chose not to for safety, we would have a live service right here. You would watch it at home, and we'd be worshiping. But the deacons are going to talk about safety protocols tomorrow. If you have input on how safe you feel meeting on Sundays or not, tell them. They don't have to quote you by name. We want to hear from you. Bottom line, my job and what keeps me up at night is how can we stay safe so that we don't have a COVID outbreak? That's the hardest thing I deal with. So you give us feedback, but we've got a good system in place today. I feel good about it. I do think we'll have to work on a few things that we got to be careful with in here, but we'll do the best we can. But we will never stop worshiping. So deacons tomorrow night, 6:30. Handbells tonight at 5:30. But deacons tomorrow night at 6:30. So I'll give you an update this week on how things are going. But I just want you to know that your church is still in action and still moving forward, whatever happens. So God bless you. Thank you for coming. We're going to continue to worship the Lord this day, and let this be a good day.
Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. And you are welcome to sing with us if you know it.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, let us sing, power and majesty.
What a blessing. Amen? What a blessing. Great. We come to the Lord in prayer, and I know there are a lot of prayer needs. I'm going to mention some. Got a word from Beth. I want to continue to pray for Katie Rucker. She's just having some bumps in the road as she deals with her health issues. Nancy Webster's back at Fairmont. Of course, our own, the Elms of Lynchburg, we have Gladys Mason, the Carrington, Janice Meek, Homebound, Clem Sweet. Continue to pray for Danny Booker as he heals with his ankle. Drew Carey and little baby Mason, we pray for, and we just continue. I'm so thankful Carey gives us such good updates. I mean, he just lets you know to keep praying, and I'm looking forward to, Carey, if you're watching this, more photos when you get them, praying for that little guy. So lots going on there. Continue to pray for those who are grieving and those who are hurting. I'll give you a chance to mention names. Continue to pray for those in the school system and workforce that are adjusting and trying to deal with these changing dynamics and worries. COVID is up 70%. About one in 700 and something Americans got COVID last week. In Virginia. One in 700 and something in Virginia. And in the whole U.S., one in 300 and something got COVID last week. So it is definitely clipping along at a fast pace. We have to be safe out there. So pray for our healthcare frontline folks who go in every day working with folks who have it and so or could be around. So pray. My childhood boss, my older brother, I and my younger brother worked at the small town Kentucky grocery store, Nortonville Supermarket, and my boss died this week of COVID. Got sick in the morning and gone that day. So grieving for a fine man who gave a chance on me, taught me how to grind hamburger meat and cut up chickens. So may he bless his heart for putting up with me. So we'll just remember folks like that. We continue to pray together as we seek God. And then now as we get closer to Thanksgiving, I'll give you a moment to, in a minute in the prayer, to give gratitude. I am thankful for you as a church every day to be your pastor. I'm thankful for my family, my friends, every day of health. This wonderful weather. I know some of you are people that want that snow stuff. Me, I'd like to see it just stay spring-like year-round. But every day you can get out, I'm thankful for just life and the goodness that God gives, the time and the quality I have with those I love. I'm thankful for everything. So every day you wake up is a gift from God. Be grateful. So let us pray this day. Gracious God, we lift up in prayer this day these names. God, we also give thanks for the following. God, we come on a day which is a gift from you. Every single 24-hour day is a gift from above. So often we just take that for granted. We maybe moan and complain about the weather or what we have to do that day or getting out of bed. But instead, we should be very grateful because we get to get out of bed. We get to step up and face a day that is precious. Each day is such a special gift. And yeah, some of it can be tough. There are things that happen we don't like, and there are things that test us and try us. But even in those days, we learn about faith and commitment. We learn about our friendships and how important they are to us. We learn gratitude. But then on the good days, sometimes we take that for granted and we ought to rejoice. What a precious gift it is to spend time with somebody we love, to take a walk around the block, to have a good meal, to see the sun rise or set. May we never be ungrateful. May we always be focused. May we always give grateful, heartfelt thanks for the blessings of life. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, and all God's people say.
Thank you. Thank you.
There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. Though you have been broken, your innocence stolen. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the darkest night. It's true, I will rescue you. There is no distance that cannot be covered over and over. You're not defenseless. I'll be your shelter, I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out an army to find you in the middle of the darkest. It's true, I will rescue you. I will never stop marching to reach you in the middle of the hardest fight. It's true, I will rescue you. Darkest night, it's true, I will rescue you. I will never stop marching to reach you in the middle of the hardest fight. It's true, I will rescue you.
We're getting close to getting our projection system all working. You'll notice the words are not up here because we got the cable running fixed, but we got computer issues. But we're going to get there, and that's okay. So we're just going to keep rolling. But I'm going to read to you from Judges chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Welcome just to listen. This is just a snippet of Deborah's life, and I would encourage you as a little homework to read Judges 4 and 5, to read the story of Deborah this afternoon or this week. That's very interesting. But let's begin. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, now that Ehud was dead. So the Lord sold them out into the hands of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. Caesarea, the commander of his army, was based in Harosheth Hagoyim, because he had 900 chariots fitted with iron and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. They cried to the Lord for help. Now Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lebaudath, was leading Israel at that time. She held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim. And the Israelites went up to her to have their disputes settled. She sent for Barak, son of Abinadab, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead them up to Mount Tabor. I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River, and give him into your hands." This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious God, take these ancient words that sound foreign to our ears, and may they speak to our life right now. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, we pray. Amen. Sometimes in life, we just keep repeating dumb things. We do. We do it. We know it's stupid. But guess what? We dig our heels in and we keep at it. That's what we do. Sometimes we just don't learn. I mean, it's one thing to try and shove a square block in a round hole. But if we keep doing it over and over, is it going to work any better? I was thinking about this as I was driving to church today about failure. And failure isn't being unsuccessful or doing what doesn't work. That's not failure. What failure is realizing it doesn't work and doing it anyway. Last 2 weeks, we explored Amos and Micah, and hopefully we were challenged by their words that we can do better. We must do better. So today, I'm not going to look at a minor prophet. I'm rewinding the Old Testament back to the days of the judges. Not the judges then were not like the Supreme Court or judges today. They did decide decisions and guide people, but they were tribal leaders guiding a nomadic people through a day that resembles the Wild West, and they were like war chiefs, and they were not afraid to get out there and fight. It was a time before the kings, before the Hebrews were organized and established, but they are free from Egypt. But Moses, who freed them, he's dead, and so is Joshua, who followed him. And now they are a people on the move, at war, struggling. The book has judge after judge coming on the scene, and you can read about them all, and they follow a scene over and over. The scene repeats itself over and over. It's called a cycle, the cycle of judges. What happens is they get into trouble because of their sin, and they make a mess. They cry out after they are oppressed for their sin. They beg for God. They promise they'll do better. God sends them someone to deliver them, a judge. You can read about Gideon and Samson, and today we're talking about Deborah. And then they're rescued, they rejoice, time passes, and then they forget what God did, and they repeat it all over, start all over again. Rebel, sin, trouble, cry, rescue, back at it. Round and round, over and over, a cycle, a sin cycle it's been called. Now, we're not like that, are we? Thousands of years later, it sounds familiar. Judges 4, though, is a snippet of all of those moments. You can see so many of these stories in Judges. This one I chose today is the calling of a female judge, the only female judge listed, Deborah. And we can take a peek at this story of Deborah and remembering that this story speaks to us today. And so as we look at this text, before I give you some things that can really be concrete for you today, I'm going to take you through it by using three different words. And they're very simple words, but it just kind of just as hooks to keep you going as you read this story, particularly if you'll read it at home. And the first word I'll offer you is a simple word. And the word is this: again. Again. Again and again, we do this stuff. We go round and round. Once again, they are at it. They do evil. They've done it before, and they're doing it again. Their judge Ehud is dead. He was a previous judge. And with his death, they go back to doing stupid stuff. They have short-term memory indeed. What about us? Do we find ourselves again, 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 doing what hurts us again, 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 or hurts others, or keeps us from having the life we want? This sermon may be hard to hear, because the question really what we're asking is, where are we? And where do we want to go? If what we're doing is stopping us from where we want to go, stopping us from our destination, are we ready right now, wherever you are in your life, to make concrete, literal steps that will change the situation? Decisions and actions and attitudes. This can be difficult. Again. The other word as you read this story, again is a big word, but also a word, so. So. God keeps trying to break that cycle. The scripture says, so the Lord sold them into the hands of King Jabin of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. God allows them to face the consequences of their action. Because they do this again, so what's going to happen? I heard someone recently say there really is no karma. Now, karma is the idea from Hinduism that you do something and it's going to come back and get you. You do something bad, you're going to get what you deserve. We use that all the time and don't even realize it's a Hindu concept. But really, a better way of seeing it in my mind is just consequences. Do something dumb, but what do we expect? Verse 3, as you read this story, tells us that their enemies had 900 chariots fitted with iron, and because of their superior armed forces, the result of their sin is that they are oppressing the Hebrews for 20 years. Let that sink in for a moment. The consequences of their bad actions cost them 20 years of misery. This is not a momentary result. This is not just a bad day. We've been living with COVID for 8 months. Lord have mercy if it was 20 years like this, right? Whew. This means that their bad actions in this story and their continual rebellion is really costing them. The truth is, sometimes what happens to us is not our fault. That's true, okay? But sometimes what happens to us is an impact of what we've done. And so wouldn't we want to make better decisions, make better actions so that we don't do it again, so that this doesn't happen? Because there's another little English word. There's again and there's so. But there's another little word as you read this you should consider and I should consider. And it's simple. And the word is now. Why not stop now? Why not break the cycle now, not later? Verse 4 is another now moment, another chance. A judge steps up now. And this time we have an outlier. God always surprises the Hebrews and us. In a patriarchal, male-dominated world, we get a female judge named Deborah. I once had somebody push back at me in a Bible study saying she can't be a judge. She has to be an assistant judge because she's a female. I don't know about them, but she is fully a judge here. And you can see as you read the story, it's quite clear that she is. But we have to know that in this day and time, this would be unusual, certainly. Again, in the Bible, if we just read it, we see women called all the time because God calls women and men. And we know that. So Deborah's here. She's ready. She's a prophet. This is not a sort of prophet or an assistant prophet. She's a prophet, much like Micah and Amos much later. She's a prophet. She just didn't write any books. Not all the prophets in the Old Testament did. She's a wife too, but she's a prophet, a woman in her own right. And she's not defined, if you read this story, she's not just defined by her husband. She is defined by her own leadership and talents. Make no mistake, she is leading Israel. They don't have kings. She's in charge. She holds court. She makes decisions. She helps and guides. She settles their disputes. Okay. And if you read the story and past our text, you'll see that she calls the leader Barak to get his men and go to war. She tells him to go to war. The deliverance is... gets really... 4 and 5, and you get the whole story. And what you find is that Barak, this mighty warrior, is terrified and afraid of the enemy. And he says he'll do it, but not by himself. He says, I'll go if you go. He will only do it if she's by his side. And the scripture wants you to catch the irony in this male-driven world that this big warrior is not willing to go unless she goes with him. This is not what any man would have supposedly said then, but he sure does. And I love this. I wish we could see her expression. I suspect Deborah just sort of smirks and laughs as she says, very well, I'll go with you. And she's not afraid. She's not meek and mild, but she adds something that's really interesting. She says, I'll go with you, but because of the way you are going about this, honor will not be yours, for the Lord will hand Caesarea over to a woman. Do you see what she's doing? She's saying, you turkey. He's not going to slay the enemy. A woman will. Again, revolutionary. And the scenes that follow, I'm going to warn you if you read this at home, don't tuck your kids in bed at tonight if they're 4 and 5 years old and say, Pastor Derek said to read this, so let's read Judges 4 and 5 before I put you to bed. Don't! Oh my goodness! This is not VBS material. No, the Bible at times is not rated PG. Jael, a female, is the one who will slay Caesarea, and it involves a tent peg, and that's all I'm saying. It's terrible! War is always terrible and bloody. Veterans Day was this week. Come on, we know war is not G-rated. Chapter 5, after this, is one of the earliest forms of Hebrew poetry that celebrates all this. And because of this, the land has peace for 40 years. That's a really good consequence. By making the right decisions, they get 40 years of peace. And they would have had more, but they keep repeating. Round and round it goes. Cycle, cycle, cycle. This is only chapter 4 of the book. It goes on and on. Okay, this round and round business is our round and round business. We spend our lives on a roller coaster of faith, up and down. We're with it and outside of it. But thanks be to God, there is a God who forgives and gives us second, third, and on chances. But again, if we could just get this, if we could just stop right now, if we can avoid the bad decisions now, just how much better our life would be. There are times we blow it. But we can't shrug our shoulders and say, that's just the way it is. We have to rise above it. We have to, and this is my challenge to all of us, break the cycles that keep us from being who God wants us to be. Break those cycles, whatever they are. Physical, financial, social, relationship-wise, whatever cycle is causing you misery today, and you know it, and you can even spell it out if you wanted to. We've got to break it. It takes hard work, it's not easy, but we've got to. And that is what Jesus is calling us to do today. Break it, shatter it, stop the insanity. Become the person God wants us to be. It is a change that will transform your world. I got you, preacher, sounds good, got you. But give me something. So I'm going to give you two quick tips, just two, and they're so simple that you can do this. The first is this. As we break the cycle, you got to remember this. Okay, the decision to do better is ongoing. I wish it were not. I wish you could just walk an aisle, pray a prayer, and lose 25 pounds. You with me? We'd have a revival, right? But it isn't, because my Cheez-Its are calling me when the TV's on. It's going to take work. In 1993, Anders Ericsson was a cognitive psychologist who published a paper that examined the distinctions among piano students of differing abilities. He looked at those who perform at an elite level and those who are average. He didn't look at people like me who can't even play. Ericsson found that the key difference between a musician capable of performing at Carnegie Hall and one who just plays locally and everybody kind of enjoys is one thing. Practice. Yeah, practice makes perfect. Going on going, consistent, staying with it. Not, you don't just learn the piano once. Now, he determined that scientists have researched all that it takes to make a musician a pro. They've studied what it makes to excel in sports and other areas of life. And it takes memory, physical qualities, the age we learn the skill, and how we deal with mistakes that will make you a pro. Still, you can have all that, but without the practice piece, will fail. We all know plenty of folks in whatever field you pick who could have reached for the stars, and they're not. Many of you know about Malcolm Gladwell, great author and speaker. He calls it the 10,000 hour rule. If you do it over and over for about 10,000 hours, you're going to be pretty good at it. So that's the rock band playing in the garage over and over while mom does this. That's the kid kicking the ball in the yard all day long. The violinist playing all afternoon while his or her friends are out in the yard playing in the summer. The kid that reads those books over and over and over. The preacher practicing and practicing many lame sermons. It's practice. With life, it means we have to stay with it. I just read a biography about William Shakespeare. I was curious. I'd never really read a biography about William Shakespeare. My cousin who passed away was an English teacher and had a lot of great books. And so I read it. And what fascinated me was that when he put on those plays that he had written, he also starred in many of them. But when he did that, this is the way it would go back then. They would do what's called the run of a new play for 4 to 6 weeks. Mornings were rehearsals, then they would perform in the afternoon, and then that night they would go over their lines to make sure they were ready. And all of this was going on every day while Shakespeare was still doing that, working with them, and writing new plays on the side. I don't see how he did it. He was constant. One commentator said that the basic secret genius for William Shakespeare was this. Are you ready? What made William Shakespeare, someone that we study in English class today still, one of the most brilliant writers in English history? What is it that made William Shakespeare the William Shakespeare? Here's how he summed it up. You don't even have to read the book now. I'm going to give it to you. Two words. Hard work. Hard work. Christian discipleship means we don't get baptized and live a problem-free life. We got to do some hard work. We have to pray, study the Bible, come to worship, Bible study, doing ministry, stewardship, giving our lives daily. hard work. We need to stop telling our kids it's going to be easy. You know, it's going to be hard. You want to do it, it's going to be hard, but it's worth it. The things that are worth it are worth the hard work. There's nothing wrong with hard work. So that's number one. And there's only one more suggestion for me, and that is, yes, it's ongoing, but while you're doing it, you have to stay focused. So ongoing and focus. You got to stay focused. There is so much it will take your eyes off the prize. Paul mentions in the New Testament we have to keep our eyes on the prize to please God, follow God, Christ-centered. Dr. Audrey West, a professor, mentioned a video. This blew me away. It was about archery, and you shoot an arrow. It starts with a young man tossing a 6-inch wooden disc into the air above his head. The archer shoots, and that arrow goes right into the center of that 6-inch wooden disc and shatters it. A high-speed camera catches the motion. Amazing. Then they throw a smaller object, a 2.5-inch plastic ball. He hits the center again. They keep throwing objects, getting smaller and smaller. They do a golf ball, a lifesaver candy, arrow, center. Finally, they throw an aspirin tablet into the air, and boom, the arrow hits the aspirin tablet. This is one good archer. When the show is over, they ask the archer how he could use a handmade bow and do this even when the targets get smaller, smaller, smaller. And here's what he said, quote, "The center of an aspirin is exactly the same size as the center of a beach ball. You just always aim for the center. The arrow tip is the same size. The objects are getting smaller, but the arrow tip doesn't change, and the center is always there." In church and life, it's the edges that are going to mess you up. You stay focused on the center, you'll achieve your goal. But there's so much around it, so much here. And the further we get away from the center, the more likely we are to just totally miss it. God knows this because the word sin means, in Greek, an archer who shoots an arrow and misses the target, the center. So all my life, I have based my entire ministry on two concepts, and I get it from Jesus, and so if you don't like it, talk to Jesus. But when people ask me what it's all about, what's the gospel all about, what do you believe is it's all about, I always tell them what Jesus said, love God, love others. And I've had people push back and say, that's too simple, I want it, give it to me, preach, it's got to be more than that. I'm glad it's not, because the loving God and loving others, I haven't got figured out yet either. So don't give me a third and a fourth, because I'm working on this. So that's our focus. And I'm like you, the target is getting smaller and smaller these days, as we are the church. But the center is love, and we have to stay focused. When COVID is in the rearview mirror and people are coming out more and more, we're going to be okay, because we, I believe, for 6-8 months have stayed focused, razor sharp, laser focused on the love of God. And that's what makes me get up after 13 years and still be your pastor. I want to tell you two quick stories about people who got the focus, just to challenge you. This really excited me this week. Amy Purdy was 19 years old with her life ahead of her when she got the flu. She took a nap and she woke up and her hands and feet were purple. She had a fatal form of meningitis. Now, she loved snowboarding and the prosthetic legs they had did not work. So she had someone design a set that would work with snowboarding that got her the bronze medal in the Paralympic Games. And because of that, she founded Adaptive Action Sports for people like her, and she even got on Dancing with the Stars. And she said this, "I'm never going to feel sorry for myself. I'm going to snowboard again, and then whatever I figure this out, I want to help other people do the same." Then I read about Robert Young, businessman, a lot of money, very successful. He picked up a newspaper one day that talked about elderly people freezing to death, and he couldn't sleep. He read about the poverty on Native American reservations, and his heart shattered. So he started Adopt a Grandparent for Native American Elders. And he adopted a 78-year-old woman by the name of Catherine Redfeather, and they even got some friends together to build her a house. Still, God didn't let him go. So he quit his successful financial business, moved to Montana, and he has started and runs the Redfeather Development Group to build houses for Native Americans. I could continue with these. I could go on and on with stories, but these stories show us people who did not buy into the round and round the way our world goes. Instead, they found God speaking to them, and they decided to do something. They decided to be something. Life in one case wasn't fair, and in the other, it wasn't very good. But in both, God had plans to take what was to be what could be, a better target, take the pain and change lives, take the talent and do something. Folks, I close with this. Our world continues to go round and round, and it always will, and it always has. Tooth and claw, me first, stuff rules, division is the norm. And these cycles will lead to more pain and misery and no way forward. But that's not what we're about. Faith in God says there is more. So where are you? What is your situation? What can God do if we simply allow God to do it? I'm going to close with step up, step out, and let's do better. Let's be better. Round and round, I'll pass on that. Forward and upward, that's my choice. And that's what we will choose together. Let's pray. Gracious God, please bless this time together. May we be the people you so desperately need us to be in a world that so desperately needs your love, your grace, and your mercy. In Christ's name, all God's people say, amen. I want to close with our benediction, and then we're going to leave. Our benediction is actually a prayer for our shoeboxes. I want you to imagine they're all piled up right here. I don't know how many we have this year. I have not heard. Does anybody know the number? Well, I'll put that on Facebook when I get it. Do we know the number? Not yet. Put it. And it may not be as many as we had last year. And do not feel bad about that, because it was hard for a lot of our folks who normally would go shopping and get it. They stayed home. So, and you should if you did. So it'll be different. That's okay. We're going to do what we got. But we're going to pray for a blessing, because those are still going to go into the lives of kids and families. And we are excited. And God sees that pile right here. God sees that. Just like we never see the children that get it. So this prayer will be for them, and then we'll leave. I'm going to ask you, one of the things we're going to have to do as we leave, as we continue to stay safe, I'm going to plead with you as your pastor to continue to be as safe as you can. Wear your mask in public. Keep 6 feet away. People get in your personal space. You finally got the time to say, back off. Okay? Walmart, grocery store, be as safe as you can. Wash your hands. I mean, do all that. When we leave the church today, I know you want to see each other. Wait till you get out. Don't cross over, maybe row by row, kind of get out. One of the things I'm going to challenge us to work on as we try to continue to worship is coming in and out to just not get too close, because the last thing I want is someone to get COVID. I want you to stay safe and healthy. But be safe. If you begin to get nervous about being in crowds, we got us online. But just be safe this week. So this will be our prayer for our shoeboxes, and it will also be our prayer as we leave. Let's pray. Gracious God, these boxes that have been given by so many, not just in this church, but churches all around, are going to help the lives of people who are experiencing a lot more struggle than we are, even in this COVID time. They live in poverty, and they live in situations of war and turmoil, and I just pray that they'll know that there is hope, there is love. I pray that we will not just stop in sending a box to some children across the world, we will also bless the children in our own lives, in our own neighborhoods, to share that same love and hope that they too need. So thank you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, go now in peace. Amen. God bless you.